love you, sir. Welcome.
Hey, you look good. Tell your neighbor you look good. Mambia, you look smart.
You know, kuna mtu ako smart.
Mwambie you look smart. Na kama unajiona huko smart sana, mwambie na mimi, next time takuwa smart kabisa. Tell them you look good. You appreciate them. We bless the name of the Lord. Thank you for coming to our service today. This is a great day. Amen. I want to ask Carol and Ethan. I want to ask the family, the Mareras, please. We want to pray for them. And as we do so, let's join a song that is our prayer for them. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah. Caro, those guys cannot see you. Can you see them? Can you get to a place where you can see them? Right. Guide me, O the great Jehovah. You bring through this barren land. I am weak, and thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more.
But it's good for you to hear the words. The first one, we have said the Lord to guide us. But this, the second one said, let the fire and the cloud, the pillar, lead me all my journey through. Strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. Amen. And let's sing like we have faith and we are declaring something to Caro and Ethan. I'll tell you why I want you to declare those words to them. Open now
the crates of fountain, where the healing stream doth flow. Let the fire and cloudy pillar lead me on my journey through.
By the way, nisukari tuwe miaribu koo zetu, eh? Tuimbe kifungu cha kwanza tena, tujaribu.
Guide me on the great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty.
Is the Lord.
The earth is the Lord.
And the fullness thereof.
And the fullness thereof.
Now look at another one. Huyo ni kama hata hana imani. Mwambie the earth is the Lord.
The earth is the Lord.
And the fullness thereof.
And the fullness thereof.
I want to ask the ministry team to some of you to climb up here. And as you do so, I'm going to give Caro this mic to tell us why we are praying for her to be guided. Eh? Amen.
Praise the Lord. Ethan, God opened a door for Ethan and I to be permanent residents in Australia. It's been a journey of faith, and I thank God. When I started the journey, I told God, if it's not your will, do not open that door. So I have the confidence that this is God's will. We'll be traveling on Thursday. We'll miss this fellowship. It has been our home for the last 10 years. I have been healed, rebuked, built in this place. And it's the way we sang, it's a place where healing takes place. May God bless you.
So get me up. Let's stretch our hands as they leave on Thursday, that the Lord will go with them. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we lay hands on Caro and Ethan. We also lay hands on the larger family of Peterson and Jane. And Lord God Almighty, as we have sung, that you guide and lead Caro and Ethan, and that you're going to be their strength and their deliverer. We speak favor of God, and we speak to Australia, because the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Australia, Australia, you cannot withhold the inheritance and the blessings of Caro and Ethan in the mighty name of Jesus. Therefore, Lord, we pray that favor of God, even as I travel, wherever there will be the transiting, Lord God, may the favor of the Lord pursue them and even overtake them. In this year of divine elevation, may you continually elevating them in the mighty name of Jesus. We honor you and we give you thanks. As the grandparents are left behind, the aunties and the uncles, and the cousins that are there on the larger scale, we pray that Heavenly Father, you will, by your own grace, in your own divine time, connect them with us. We want to leave the communication avenue wide open, that Caro and this church will continually communicate and fellowship. Pray that they will find a church, a warm fellowship, where they will continue serving you like they did here, to the praise and to the glory of your DNA. For this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen and amen. As they sit, amen. As they sit, you can also sit. And maybe that is better. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We are talking about divine elevation. Tell your neighbor, divine elevation. And there are many ways that God is going to elevate us. But the word that you hear is when you make it yours, personalize it, and defend it. Speak about it when you lie down and when you wake up. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In this year of divine elevation, you know, sometimes I don't talk about the things that God does. But allow me to say this one. Because it happened, we had gone to Nakuru for prayer. And one of my sons, I also have sons, people that believe in me. So one of those people that believe in me came and said, Bishop, please speak in my life. This year of divine elevation. And I said a few things. I cannot even remember the sequence. But I said, this year, uinuliwe paka ushangae, you know. And the guy connected with me. He said, I cannot go without a sacrifice. So he blessed me. This week, which is ending, we have been traveling. We have been moving around. 1 week is over. He called me and said, Bishop, you cannot believe. Nimepewa gari. What do I do with it? Mtu akikwambia unamwambia namna gani? Ingia ndani, gurumisha kama ina mafuta, uendeshe kama una barua. Now, this is what God is going to do. I felt I need to let you know that when God elevates us, there are people that will bring that which they have been holding for us in this year of divine elevation. But divine elevation to happen, there are certain things that you and I ought to do. Get the word of God, defend it. If God has said this is my year of elevation, hata shetani na watu wa kwetu na anaye nijiri akisema contrary, nitamwambia anyamaze kidogo. Ayubu alimwambia mke wake, wacha kuongea kama wa mama. Ninaomba wazee wengine mtaambia wake wenu hivyo. Tika kualia tamutumia. Na nyinyi wa mama muambie wazee, wacha kuombea kama mkikuyu mwanaume. Yani kwa sababu vile Bwana amesema, it shall come to pass in Jesus' name. So guard that word, protect that word, defend that word, run with that word. Are you a visitor? You know, it's also good to remember there are visitors. Are you a visitor? We are sorry that we can only apologize that here we are being elevated. We want you to join in the wagon of those that are being elevated. If you lift up your hand, I want to acknowledge you very quickly and welcome you in the house of the Lord. Are you visiting us today for the very first time? You've never been here before. This is your... Oh, there is a visitor up there at the corner over there. There is another visitor behind Peterson. Peterson, karibisha huyo mgeni ako hapo. Huyo dada, asante sana. Any other visitor that you spoke? Oh, there are many there. There are many visitors there. So you stretch your hand to the visitors next to you. Chebet, huyo visitor, si unamsalimia na mwambia karibu church yetu ni poa. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You can make the seat you have sat your seat, make it permanent. May the Lord elevate you to another level. Amen. Our speaker this morning, and although she is a dynamic speaker, saingine tunaombaga ile saa ikatae kwenda, lakini bado inaenda. Najua saa ikatae kwenda, because right now, according to that clock, I don't think she has a lot of time, but let's allow the Spirit of the Lord to use her. So that time, let no time to be a factor. Sawa, sawa. Kama unasaa usiangalie, mwambie jirani yako, ninaona uko nasaa, lakini wacha kuangalia. Fungua moyo wako, iliweze kubarikiwa. Let's all arise and welcome Pastor Elizabeth Jerry Kongo to bring the word of God to us today. Let's appreciate her. Let's appreciate.
Let's give a clap to our bishop, the prophet of God in the house this morning. Hallelujah. You are well? You look great. You look beautiful. Let's pray together. Our Father and our God, you are able to speak in a long time and in a short time. Pray that you speak to me, speak to my listeners. Father, may be able to connect with your word and activate it in our lives. That Father, as we declare this morning, our lives will never, ever, ever be the same again after hearing this word. For we ask it and believe it in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Amen. You may sit down with a smile in the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, church. Bwana asifiwe sana. I'm Elizabeth. I'm born again this morning. I love Jesus. He's my personal savior. He's my reason for living. And we have a covenant relationship with Jesus. And where he's taking me is far before I get to heaven. Bwana asifiwe sana. I'm going places before I go to heaven. I'm also going to heaven. Praise the Lord. So we are talking of year of elevation. And I want to speak on a topic, activating divine elevation through sacrifice. Activating divine elevation through sacrifice. And what is elevation? We've been talked about it for the last like two Sundays and even the New Year overnight prayer meeting. And we are talking of promotion. Elevation is promotion. It's upgrading. It's advancement, exaltation, nobility, creation. You're able to create. You are creative in your mind. You are rising up. You are ascending. And many other adjectives that you can use to define elevation. And what is a sacrifice? An act of giving up something that you want to keep. At this point, may I mention, a sacrifice is not your tithe, because a tithe you pay. A sacrifice is not your offering that you bring to the house of prayer every time we gather. A sacrifice is way beyond the tithe and offering. And it must be something that you feel. A sacrifice, you'll know I gave it. Even after a year, if I ask you what your yearly sacrifice was, you'll remember, because it was something you'd have wanted to keep, but you gave it out for a reason. And a sacrifice is given to a deity. And in our case, our deity is our Almighty God. We are looking at a few introductory remarks I want to make. John 13 verse 17. It says, now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. As we unveil some truth this morning, the untruths we are unveiling, if you do them, you'll be blessed if you practice them. In the book of John 8:32, it says, then you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. When we got born again, we got to know that we were sinners. We confessed our sins, and we were set free from sins. We were delivered. Why? A truth was revealed to us. We activated it in our lives, and that's why you and me have a testimony this morning that we are born again Christians. In Ecclesiastes 7:12, in the New King James, it says, for wisdom is a defense as money is a defense. For wisdom is a defense as money is a defense. I'm only quoting part of it. You can read the whole of it. The Message Bible says, wisdom is better when it's paired with money. It's good to be wise. But when wisdom is paired up with money, and if you get them both when you are alive, if you get them both when you are still living, it's even better. So don't wait. Don't wait. Don't wait. Get it now. Get wisdom and get money and get wealth. In the book of Ecclesiastes 19 and part B, but money is the answer for everything. There are many things it said, for wisdom is a defense, as money is a defense, but the excellence of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to those who have it. But that is verse 12. I wanted verse 9. Ecclesiastes 10, 19, sorry. But money is the answer for everything. In the Message Bible, it says, but it's money that makes the world go around. And I was giving an example this morning. I have a car. But even if I wanted to visit you on a Saturday afternoon and I don't have money to fuel it, and you're all the way in Nakuru, I may not come because I can't come in an afternoon and come back in a matatu. But with a car driving 2 hours to Nakuru, 1 hour fellowship, 2 hours drive back. But with all the money, I won't go around. Okay, take it the other way. You want to visit me. You stay in Kayore. And you have to pay fare all the way to KU where I live. If you have no fare, even though you have the time, you won't go around. So money takes you. Do you believe it? You know, if you have no money, this is for true and for real, you are defenseless. Did you know that? You want to engage a lawyer this morning? Before even he starts the case, he wants a deposit. And these days they ask for a lot of money. They'll tell you the case is 200,000 and I have to have 100,000 deposit. You are defenseless. Because now if you don't pay the lawyer, you can't be defended. Money is a defense. And let me say this, poverty is horrible. Poverty is horribleness, it's not holiness. At because you are poor, you look like you are holy. It's not. Poverty is horrible. And I said this morning, if you are a pastor of a poor church, it's very bad. It's very sad. Because most of the time you may be cursing your members instead of blessing them. I go to my closet because my children haven't gone to school. I'm thinking, these people, I keep preaching, they don't give enough tithes, they don't bring their tithes, they don't pay offerings. And I'm complaining before the Lord. Is that a blessing? I may be cursing you. It is bad. And I pray for those of us who are desiring to open a church, pray that for your members in our device, that you not pastor poor members. It is dangerous. I'm also saying the devil responds to our prayers. He does. He does. Does he? Yeah, because if you rebuke him, he'll go. But let me tell you, the devil will not only respond to prayers. Prayers he can reverse. And I'm not saying it's bad to pray. It's very good. It's also very good to pray and fast like we are doing. We are in 40 days prayer and fasting. This is our 15th day. And I thank God he's giving us grace and strength. We don't look like we are dropping dead because you have fasted for two weeks, do we? We have the grace and the strength. It is, okay, prayer is the minimal. Prayer and fasting, we are here, middle. When you do prayer and you fast, then you sacrifice. Oh, the devil can never fight your sacrifice. And the world, the wicked world knows, at times seems to know better than we do. Ukienda kwa muganga, mesikia wale wameenda, anambiaga wete, ulende, ulete, maybe 10,000 in Githurai or in Zimmerman, alafu utafute buzi mweusi, panya, amekufa. At times you'll be even asked for mafia panya. They do all sorts of things. They ask all sorts of things. They dictate their sacrifice. Why they know? If they activate their altars with your sacrifice, they'll be able to connect to you. Now it's amazing when we come to the house of the Lord. You have been praying against those people who pray against them, who have mistreated over you over the years. They give a bigger sacrifice than you on the altars they worship. Now today I want to challenge you. You can raise. And remember I said it's not about a tithe and offering. I'm talking of a sacrifice. Today we can include our sacrifice in our praying and fasting. In the book of Psalms, that 7:23, I'm trying to go quickly. So go with me. The steps of a righteous man are ordered of the Lord. It's part of that scripture. And in verse 25 it says, the righteous are not forsaken. Their children don't beg for bread. Are we together? That's the scripture. Now, unless you allow the Lord to order your steps and activate the ordering, you may find yourself forsaken. You may find yourself having children who are begging for bread. May it never be a portion of any one of us hearing me this morning in the name of Jesus. Gathering and collecting, that's Ecclesiastes 2:26, it says, part of it, the wicked are given the task of gathering and collecting that he may give to him who is good before God. Did you hear me? These people are busy. Their task is to amass the wealth so that at the appointed time it may be given to the righteous. So you may see a gari. Within less than a month, we left Nakuru on 6th, and today is 15th. He heard the voice of the Lord, the pastor heard, and he didn't delay. He connected to the bishop with a sacrifice. He has a new car. Maybe your car has only been locked up because you have never known the truth behind this pulpit. Hear me and hear me well. Your prophet is your prophet. Does that sound familiar? Your prophet is your prophet. Now, let me come out clearly. Our prophet ministers on this altar with many of us. And may I say that he has the right. Did you hear me? He has the right of eating from the gospel together with his fellow pastors. And this morning I was asking my fellow Express members, how many of us have been here 32 years? They may not even end up to two. Our bishop and pastor Alice have been here 32 years in this altar ministering. You have come, you have found a new sanctuary. You have come from far. You are enjoying the blessings that people have labored over the years, led by the prophet in the house. And you want to wonder, how can he drive a Volkswagen around Tuareg where I have no car and he's asking for a sacrifice? Let me tell you, you are not age mates, you are not equals. Even if you are age mates, you are not equals. If he's your prophet, the anointing upon his life is so heavy, you can't compare. That's why you are living in this congregation. And I'm saying this, the anointing that you honor will bless you. You will benefit from it. We have just said our prophet, our prophet. But until you honor the prophet in the house and honor the anointing upon his life and know that you cannot be equals with our father and the mother in the house, you may miss it. So I call upon you, my brothers and my sisters, learn to honor the anointing in the house. Learn to honor the prophet of God in the house. Imagine somebody who doesn't even worship here is already benefiting from the anointing in his life. And you are seated there and you are struggling all your life. If I were you today, would be my day, and I would say, it's over. I'm connecting with the prophet of God in my life. Bwana asifiwe sana. You can say with me, because I hate poverty, I hate poverty, I hate poverty. You can say, just say with me, I hate poverty. Poverty is not holiness. It is holiness. Amen. And what will I do? I will activate the principles, the financial principles of God in my life, so that I can break the yoke of poverty in my life. Bwana asifiwe. Amen. Let me say this. Tongues will edify yourself. When you are filled with the Holy Ghost, and I love speaking and praying in tongues, it's wonderful. You connect to the heavenlies direct. But you know what? As you do that, you're edifying yourself. You edify your life. You edify yourself. But did you know money? Money edifies your status. Money edifies your... You remember the days people died in the village and you were never informed? But these days they'll wonder. They called you the first day, you didn't say anything. The third day and the fourth day. And then unafika, unauliza mumefika wapi? Tulikuwa tunakugoja. It happened. One of my cousins passed on. And I got there after Wednesday. It was Saturday. And I'm asking them, so what are we? Where are we? What is the plan? They said, tulikuwa tunakugoja. Since Wednesday. And today is the Saturday. And sure enough, we formed a committee, contributed the money. We dictated the day of the burial. And thus my cousin was buried. That hasn't happened all the years. It started happening under the anointing in this house. Bwana asifiwe. We can give a clap to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's good. In the book of Genesis chapter 26, I'll pick a few verses. You can follow me as I do so. In verse 1, the Bible records there was famine in the land like that of Abraham's time. And I said the famine in the land, this is Isaac's days. His father, in Genesis 12, verse 10, it says the same. There was famine in the land, and Abraham went down to Egypt because he was dying of hunger. Bwana asifiwe sana. And we are saying, Isaac went down to Gerar, to King Abimelech. He was on his way to Egypt. But the Lord tells him, hold on. Please stay here. I'll be with you. And I'll bless you here. Amen. So I'm saying, the Lord is warning him in verse 2, do not go down to Egypt. Don't follow the principles of your ancestors. I was saying, and I'll say it again, if your father got rich, or your brothers got rich through corrupt ways, don't follow their ways. Those ways don't work in the house of the Lord. They'll kill you. They are not right. And I'm saying, may the Lord give you grace that you don't go down the ways of your fathers. Dwell in the land. Please position yourself. Position. Don't move out of the church. Do not change the status. Useme hii nao kanisa ina matoleo mingi. Mara ni tithe, mara ni offering, sasa ni sacrifice, mimi natoka. I'm telling you, like Isaac heard from the Lord, stay here. Obey me and I'll bless you. That's what the Lord is saying. And you know, in verse 12, the Bible says, then Isaac sowed in that land and reaped in the same year 100-fold, and the Lord blessed him. You know, the Lord keeps his word. When he says he bless you, he blesses. But you must position yourself for blessing. The same year he planted, imagine, we plant in January, and before the end of the year, or even before the end of the month, I love that miracle of that brother. How about a new car this year? It is doable. You only need to position yourself, connect to the Lord, connect to the prophet in the house, and it is yours for the taking. Amen. So I'm saying in our lives today, there are seeds that must be multiplied in 2017. There are sacrifices that open doors in 2017. We must be elevated. Shetani apende asipende. Watu apende wasipende. We are going. We are going because God, through his prophet, has spoken that this is our year of divine elevation. God, give us the grace. And the Bible continues. In the same verse, it says, the man began to prosper. I came to report today that there is a beginning to prosperity. If you haven't started prospering, you can start today. You can start growing and continue to prosper and become very prosperous. So that's what the verse says. The man began to prosper, continued prospering until he became very. May that be your portion in Jesus' name. Verse 14 says, he had possessions of flocks. He had possessions of flocks and possessions of herds and a great number of servants. So the Philistines did what? Yes. If you are poor, nobody envies you. Did you know that? Hata wanakuangalia wanashindwa, he? Haya. Anapita tu. So if you have not been envied yet, I want to challenge you in this 2017. It is your turn to be envied. Yes, it's your turn to be. Amen, amen. We are saying there must be secrets of prosperity. And you look at it in the scriptures, you just be looking at the scriptures. What do they say? Because it is good when the Lord speaks to us through his word. We go to another scripture in 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3 to 5. And in the first verse it says, Solomon loved the Lord. My sister, my brother, the secret to your prosperity, if you are beginning to prosper today, love the Lord. You are there, you are not born again. The things you are speaking, you will not benefit you until you give your life to Jesus Christ and start moving in the way of prosperity. Bwana asifiwe sana. Love the Lord. The second thing he did was he sacrificed to the Lord. And you know, Solomon didn't just sacrifice. He sacrificed 1, 2, 3, not 10, not 100, 1,000 bulls. Read with you, read the Bible. And when the Lord gets the smoke, remember it's the Old Testament? So the sacrifice is being burnt. Imagine 1,000 bulls on fire, the smoke, the thickness. Oh, it startled God and he wondered, where is it coming from? Where could this be coming from? And in the next verse 5, actually God could not stay in heaven. He came and he visited brother Solomon by night. And he's asking him, Solomon, what does it say? At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night. And God said, ask, what shall I give you? This could be your question tonight with the Lord. Ask, what do you want? What is it that you have been crying and praying about? Fasting, 21 days, now we are doing 40. Next time we may do 80. You can break the yoke by a sacrifice. Amen? And you know, it's interesting. Because heaven cannot speak until the earth has an overwhelming sacrifice. Maybe that's why the Lord hasn't spoken to you of late. He used to speak and you're wondering, we are talking of the good old times. We can go back to the old good days. The Lord can start speaking to us afresh. We can activate it by giving a living sacrifice. Bwana asifiwe sana. May the Lord elevate my life and decorate my life. Our theme verse this year is Genesis 41, verse 41. But before we get to that verse, actually talks of Joseph being called from prison and being elevated, being turned from a prisoner to a. But the story is longer. It takes a little longer. Remember when he was sold out by his brothers? Why? Because he had a dream. And when he dreamt and told it to his brothers, they hated him. But praise God for dreamers. They never stopped dreaming. He had another dream. This time, it was even amazing. It was the stars, the moon, And everybody bowed before him, and the father rebuked him. My brother, I want to challenge you. Get a dream that you are not even your parents. They'll even wonder, what's wrong with you? You think me, I'll bow before you and your brothers and your sisters? Whom do you think you are? That's what Jacob was telling Joseph. Sasa unafikiria mimi na mama yako, na ndugu zako tutakuabudu. We'll bow down before you. But do you know what? God is a good God. So the Bible says that this man Joseph was prepared by God, was sent before Israel into Egypt. So even when the brothers are hating him, and even when they are putting him in the pit, God is in it. He's sending Joseph. When he's put in fetters as a slave, sold to Potiphar's house as a slave, are we together? Even as he's sent to prison, not because of a sin he had committed, sababu aliwekelewa maneno, God was still in it. But the end result, because the Lord was in it, the end result is good. It was elevation. The other thing is good to note, when Joseph was promoted, there was no position of prime minister in Egypt. It was created for him. So as you get promoted by brother, don't worry about the other brothers and sisters. Nobody will be demoted because you are getting promoted. Your position will be created so long as you activate your elevation by your sacrifice. Nobody will suffer because you are getting up. Bwana asifiwe. Amen. So we are saying, I'm saying many things, but let me say this also. An altar without sacrifice will never alter your life. An altar without a sacrifice will never alter your life. In other words, an altar without your sacrifice will never change your life. Those are facts, and they are hard facts. And I explained, the wicked world knows about it. That's why they demand it. The holy altar here demands an altar from you. And the Bible is clear, none shall appear before the Lord empty-handed. Please, if you came today without an offering, we forgive you for today. But I want to declare from this day on, in the year 2017, the year of our elevation, none of us shall appear before the Lord without a sacrifice, without an offering. We will not come empty-handed. Remember, God is not mocked. He knows you and he knows me. How do I know? Ask Ananias and his wife. They died because of being financially unfaithful. And unfortunately, Mrs. Ananias used to arrive in church late. So she also didn't know that her husband had died and been buried. And she says, is this all the money? She says, yes. The same day, ida walificha na ida walileta, ikawapotea na wakazikwa. Financial unfaithfulness can cause you physical death. Amen. You want to die? Of course, by the time you are dying physically, you are already dead spiritually. That's why you are cheating. Now, please don't play around with finances. When God blesses you, he blesses you for a reason and a cause. He told Abraham, I'll bless you and I'll make you a blessing to the nations. He doesn't bless me for myself. He doesn't bless you for yourself. And it is time to know that. And when you do, then you look for ways to give out what the Lord gives you so that he can have more room to give you some more. Bwana asifiwe. Verse 4 of that book. We are doing 1 Kings chapter 3. Verse 4 says, I think that talks about the offering. It was 1,000 bulls. Verse 5, the Lord asks him what he wants, and he doesn't ask for money. He doesn't ask for wealth. And what does verse 10 say? Verse 10 says, the speech pleased the Lord. Imagine, the speech pleased the Lord, that Solomon had asked this thing. The thing he asked for was wisdom to rule the people of God, the Israelites. Be together. The speech pleased the Lord. May the Lord be pleased with your speech when you speak with him. Aikumbuke mpaka inamfurahisha atoke juu binguni kukuuliza, ask, what is it? Then when you speak with such wisdom, the Lord is so pleased. Bwana asifiwe. I'm saying there are many sacrifices, and one of them that I noted down is that there is a sacrifice for long life. I know most of us fear death. But let me tell you, kunafikaga wakati huogopi kifo. I'm living with my elderly mother. And it's like every morning she's ready to go home. And she is not struggling. Ati naogopa nisikufe leo nisi Why we fear is because it's a premature death. Are we together? You want to live long? Mpaka useme sasa Bwana niko tayari nichukue. Give a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice for long life. Bwana asifiwe. And I want to say, it's also bad to be a member of this church and you're not giving your offerings. And by the way, I'm not telling you to give tithe and offerings when I don't. Because there is my offering, there is my tithe, and there is also my sacrifice. Because it's personal. Bishop cannot stand here and tell us to give an offering and a tithe when he's not paying. He does pay. Did you know that? For himself, for his family. And then these are also tithes. The money you bring to us, we also tithe to the national office. Are we together? So the things we are teaching you, we are practicing them. Please practice them. Mototo kia horo akuluta tithe na mhothi. Raini to akuluta sacrifice. Bwana asifiwe sana. Amen. Nimesema mtufuate. Follow nyayo zetu. Tunapotoa tithe na offering na sacrifice. Bwana asifiwe sana. Verse 12 says, behold, I've done according to your words. May this be my portion this year. May the Lord do according to what you'll ask him. But you know he can do it. He's a good God. He loves you, he loves me. But he desires. Remember I started with chapter 3, 13, verse 17 of John. These things that you know, if you do them, you are blessed. And verse 13. And I have also given you what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that there shall not be anyone like you among the kings all your days. Hakuuliza pesa na utajiri. But the Lord also added, my sister, my brother, maybe even as we give a sacrifice, you may not ask many things. You may just ask the Lord, give me the thirst and hunger for yourself, for the things of God. Let me tell you, he'll also add the things you didn't ask. But be wise. May your speech please the Lord so that you ask the things that are right. Amen. And then as we move on, we'll look very, very quickly as we finish in the book of 1 Samuel. Chapter 1 of 1 Samuel. The story of Hannah, most of us may know the story or we remember it. But the story was that of Elkanah, who had two wives. One was Penina, one was Hannah. Penina had children, sons and daughters. Hannah had no children. And one of the things I want us to pick is what happened in this man's life every year. Verse 3 of that chapter. Year after year, this man went up from his town to worship and sacrifice to the Lord Almighty at Shiloh, where Hophni and Phinehas, the two sons of Eli, were priests of the Lord. They went to where? Elkanah went to Shiloh. And there's also something else. Maybe it's good to note that whenever the day came, verse 4, for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife, Penina, and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her. And the Lord had closed her womb. The Lord had closed Hannah's womb. I want you to note something. Elkanah had two wives. So he would give the first wife, okay, Penina, I don't know that she was the first wife, Penina, and every of her sons and her daughters. Then he'd go to Anna, who had no children, and give a double portion. So if he had given 20,000 to Penina as the wife, Hannah would get 40. And the reason was, Anna was barren and the Lord had closed her womb. It wasn't the devil. It is the Lord who had closed Hannah's womb. But let's see. In a few minutes, that if you read through that chapter, Anna goes to the, that during that year sacrifice, And after everyone has sacrificed, they've gone to eat, she remains behind to pray alone. And she's praying so deeply, she's not, you know, you can't hear the voice, but her lips are moving. It's all deep until the priest of God in the house that day, Elkanah, thinks this woman must have been drunk. She came to the house of the Lord drunk. And he's telling her, how long will you keep babbling, you drunk woman? And she says, no, I'm pouring out my heart from sorrow. And she told the Lord as she prayed that day, give me a son. Somebody say, give me a son. You know, she didn't ask for any baby. If she could have said, give me a baby. She said, give me a son. And when you give me that son, after I carry him, after I bring him forth, after I've weaned him, I'll bring him to this house and I'll give him to you. Remember, she had come with double portion of a sacrifice. So it was a sacrifice, prayer, and a vow. If you read that chapter, there are many things you can pick. But I just want to mention and say this. Hannah was barren, and it was an error in Israel to be barren. The Bible says no one will be barren among the Israelites. So it was an error. And remember, we have said it's the Lord who had closed her womb. But imagine, even though the Lord had closed her womb and she gave a sacrifice and she prayed and made a vow, many things happened in her life. One, barrenness was terminated. Barrenness was terminated. May barrenness be terminated in your life. Barrenness in every area. If you are looking, asking the Lord for a baby, may he hear your voice today. But remember, it may take a sacrifice and a vow from you. Tears were terminated. Her tears dried up. The Bible reports that her face shone. She was at peace and she went back home rejoicing. Mockery was terminated. I can imagine the first man when she got pregnant, the second and the third, and she could not hide it anymore. And Penina didn't have any words. She could not be mocked anymore. Mockery was terminated by a sacrifice and a vow. And remember, the Lord is the one who had closed the womb. Now if the sacrifice and a vow can open a womb which the Lord had closed, how about that one the devil has closed? Or that witch or that sorcerer? See, she was still open. She became fruitful. She got a son, Samuel. And her sad countenance was terminated. Her value in life came by sacrifice and a vow. She received the speed of conception. You ask me, how do I know? In the book of the same book we are reading, Message Bible, verse 19 and 20 in the Message Bible, it says, up before dawn, they worshiped God and returned home to Ramah. Elkanah slept with Hannah, his wife, and God began making the necessary arrangements. Remember, it was God who had closed her womb. So after the vow and the sacrifice, they get home, and what does God start doing? He starts making the necessary arrangements in response to what she had asked. That's what a sacrifice can do in your life. She received speed to conceive, and Samuel was the outcome of a sacrifice and a vow. Bwana asifiwe sana. Let me say this as I finish and call my brother to come and finish up for us. Is that wicked altars? I talked of wicked altars. And you know they are real? Did you know they are real? Even if you don't believe in them, they are still there. And even if you don't go to them, because I don't expect you to go to them, they are still there. And those who have gone to them know they are there. When they are activated by a sacrifice, and the righteous altars, like the one I'm standing on, is not activated or it's dormant, the wickedness from the wicked altars reign over us. They will reign over our families. You'll wonder why you keep fighting and not understanding each other. Possibly there's a wicked altar near you, and it's more active. It has a bigger sacrifice than you have brought in this church. So the bigger the sacrifice, the better the results. And if it's altar, altars are the same. Only the difference is a wicked altar, this is a righteous altar. Or every altar requires a sacrifice. Now, if the wicked people know how to give sacrifices, don't you think it's a lie from the devil that when you come to church, even giving an offering is a problem? Giving your tithe is an issue because the devil knows. The moment you break through, you will be far, so far, he cannot get you. The Lord, you put a hedge round about you, and even when he works his wickedness, it can never reach your family. I'm saying this. Let's activate the righteous altar that we honor. This is our Shiloh. And we have a prophet in the house. Do you know him? Do you honor him? Now, this year, we choose to honor a prophet. And this is being done in every deliverance church. It's not in Kasarani alone. We started with our national overseer. Those of us who went to Nakuru, we have given a sacrifice, not the tithe, not the offering. We have given a sacrifice to connect to the national overseer. And he said, I expect this to be repeated in every local congregation. Honor the man of God. Honor the anointing of God. Connect with the servant of the Lord. Connect with the prophet in the house. And we are going places. Activate your divine elevation by giving a sacrifice that you pain you. May the Lord bless you as you do so. In Jesus' name, amen.